Bishut Marev Rabotai, with the permission of Hashem, I would like to wish you to all of you a good week, a good Shabbos, Shabbat Shalom, Be'ezat Hashem. Today is Thursday. Parashat Vayishlach, this beautiful parasha of Vayishlach. This parasha is the meeting, the first meeting after more than 30 years that Yaakov did not see Esav, his brother. And now this famous meeting between them. And I would like just to ask one question. Two questions. First, can you imagine Hitler kissing, giving a hug to a Hasid, to a religious rabbi? No. We cannot imagine the barbary, how the Jews, 6 million Jews, they were killed in Auschwitz, in Germany, in Poland, in Russia, Hungary, Ukraine. We cannot imagine the way they were killed. You know, it's just it's easy for you to go to see this concentration camp and you see what was going on there. So I don't understand. First, I don't see the reason why Yaakov Avinu had to meet him. Why he has to meet Esav, that he was a big Rasha. He hated Yaakov, his brother. From Esav, the Nazi came. From Esav, the Odos who killed the Jews, they come from Esav. So I don't understand why Yaakov, he wanted to meet him. Hashem, he did not tell him to go to meet him. I mean, I don't see the reason why. This meeting was for what? Why Yaakov Abinu Alav Shalom, he would not, when he come back to Eretz Canaan, to the land of his parents, why he did not come like normal? Why he had to go? Why he had to send some people to tell Esav, I'm coming. I just arrived, and I am rich. Do you think Esav will be happy to know that Yaakov is rich? And that I have slaves, I have a billionaire. I mean, Esav, he hit Yaakov. So why you have to tell him? So we have a few questions. First, why Yaakov, he had to send some people to let know Esav that he is coming? Esav don't care if you come or you don't come. I mean, and besides this, he make him nervous by telling him, you know, I am millionaire, I am rich. Okay, imagine if you talk like that to your enemy, he will hate you more. And this third question is, when Esav came to meet his brother, he came with a big army. And then, suddenly what happened? Esav, he kissed his brother. I mean, how can you imagine that? He kissed his brother, and he gave him a hug, he kissed him. We don't understand this meeting. But I want just to know why this kind of meeting, and how you can imagine a man who hit his brother, a man who hit his brother, suddenly he gave him a big hug, he kissed him, and he cried. And then he wanted to stay with him. How do you understand all this? My friend, I would like just to tell you this. We have to understand that the Torah, they want to teach us, you know, and give us some ideas for the future. Don't forget, the Jewish people, all years long, from generation to generation, always we suffer. We suffer only because we are Jewish. We are accused that we are rich. We don't mix with other people. I mean, we're not rich. I mean, yes, it can happen. Few people that they are rich. So, because of this, you have to eat the people. They have to use the Jewish people because they are rich. So it's their luck. Why is this? Why if somebody that is not Jewish is rich, nobody talk about him. But because this Jew is rich, I was in a hospital. I want to see somebody that he was not well. He was not Jew. But he is one of the richest men of the world. Because he asked me to go to visit him. And I went to visit him. And next to him, there was a Jew. That it was normal. It was not rich as this one that I saw. But he has few shops. He was maybe 10% of the wealth that this rich man was in that room. And I heard people, when they were talking about the Jew, they were telling this rich Jew. I mean, but we have to live with that. I mean, this is maybe this is the marketing that they put on us. You know, they put on us this publicity that we are rich, that we are bad people. So, unfortunately, but a lot of non-Jewish people, when really they know us, they love us. They know that we are not so bad. But when they don't know you, they think you are this, you are crazy, you are thief, you are capitalist, you are this. Yaakov Abinu Alav Shalom, he wanted to teach us a few lessons. First, you should never be ashamed of your Judaism. When Yaakov Abinu Alav Shalom, after 30 years that he was in Haran with his father-in-law and uncle Lavan, which was a big Rasha, Lavan was a big Rasha, probably Esav thought that Yaakov, now with his brother, with his uncle, must probably become like him. Yaakov Abinu, when he came to Eretz Israel, when he came back to Eretz Canaan, he declared, "Im Lavan Garti." Yes, I was living with Lavan for 30 years, more than 30 years, but I remained a big Jew, a good Jew. I did not learn from him. That was the first lesson. That you should never be ashamed to declare your Judaism. If you have a kippah on your head, don't be ashamed. I was so proud when I came from Argentina to Madrid, and they were with us some Jews. I did not know that they were Jewish. I did not know. And suddenly, near the morning, I saw them putting tefillin. I was shocked. And I went to them, I kissed them. I told them, "I'm happy. I'm proud of you that you're not ashamed. I did not know that you were Jewish. And suddenly now I see you putting tefillin. I'm proud of you." I mean, that's what we learn from Yaakov Abinu. Yaakov Abinu, alav shalom, he did not hide himself. When he came back to Eretz Israel, to the land of Canaan, he declared, you know, that "I'm back." And he's back with his Judaism. And he declared that "I did not change. I'm the same man. As the same man, the same way as I live." And that's why, and then he said to Yaakov Abinu, he said to Lavan, "And Baruch Hashem, when you follow the step of Hashem, look, when I left Eretz Canaan, I was a poor man. And I went to Haran. There in Haran, I have no money, I have nothing. And there, all the people, they were thieves, they were rishaim, they were bad people. They all were very, very bad. And there, you cannot be rich. And Baruch Hashem, because I kept my Judaism, Baruch Hashem, I am rich. I'm not rich only for myself to join the money. I'm rich with mitzvot of the money." Because people, like somebody this week, somebody, unfortunately, he lost all his money in the petrol. He was a billionaire. And he put all his money in the petrol. And unfortunately, the petrol went down, down, down. And every time, I told him, "Take out your money. Take what is left. No, maybe the petrol is going to go up, pa, 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 pa." And then the petrol become maybe $60 the barrel, all the money that he was saving for 20 years, he lost it. 20 years of work, 20 years that he was doing business, building houses, real estate, and all the money that he put it in the petrol. So today he's a poor man. He lost everything. He lived very bad because all his mind was for the money. He did not do tzedakah. He did not do nothing for his family. And now he lost everything. Even his wife, she lost him. She left him. The children are angry against him because he didn't buy them even a house where to live. With all the billions that he had. And of course, he borrowed money and borrowed money and borrowed money. Now he's without nothing. So I told him, you lost everything. I mean, Hashem give you money instead of taking the advantage to the mitzvot with the money, enjoy it, give to your parents, give to your family, buy presents to your wife, buy houses to your children, and enjoy your money. If Hashem give you money, enjoy it. Don't just keep it. Why? As the Gemara said, there is a lot of people that just, they keep money, they don't enjoy the money, and then when they die, who enjoy the money? The children. So why? You too enjoy the money. It should give you, enjoy it. But don't enjoy it just for yourself. Do good things with it, and increase your time with it. Buy a good pair of tefillin, good mezuzot, eat kosher well, and keep Shabbat. My friend, that's what Yaakov Abinu he wanted to say to his brother. Yes, he came declaring his Judaism first. That Baruch Hashem, he did not change. First. Second, I am rich, but the money that God give me, it's not just to keep it, to do Torah with it, to do mitzvah with it. And to be a Jew, you must have money. We have a lot of expensive. Brit Milah, marriage, bar mitzvah, to eat kosher, tzedakah. We have a lot of holidays. Don't think it's easy. So Hashem give us a lot of mitzvot to do, and we have to give 10%. A lot of to do all these mitzvot, we need money. If you want to have Olam Haba, Gan Eden, how can you have a Gan Eden? Only to do when you do Torah mitzvot, and to do Torah mitzvot, it costs money. A lot of mitzvot you have to spend money to do them, so we need it. It's just the pleasure to keep it, to be million, rich. No. And that's what Yaakov said to his brother. I am rich. Not rich only for the sake to be rich. To be rich, to do Torah mitzvot, and to help people, and to do good things with it. That was his message. Then the Torah said that Esav HaRasha, he came with a big army. I mean, Esav, I don't understand Esav. Instead of Esav being a little bit cool with his brother, okay, after all, my brother is a very strong man, huh? To live with bad people and to remain a tzaddik is fabulous, is fantastic. So why to come to fight him? Why? Why this hate? Why? Why? I don't understand. I mean, after all, Yaakov, he did not come with an army to fight Esav. He just wanted to tell him, Esav, we are two brothers, we are from a good family, a family of tzaddikim. Baruch Hashem, I remain tzaddik with Lavan. And Baruch Hashem, even that I am rich, don't think I am rich for my personal, because I... it's just to be rich there, it's impossible. And if I'm rich, it's not for me. It's just, it's a way to keep Torah mitzvot. But I don't care about all this. Otherwise, I don't need it. It's Hashem forced me to be rich. So instead that Esav will be happy. Tov, my brother, he came back. He's not a fighter. He don't want to fight with me. Okay, he's a tzaddik. So what? He's a tzaddik. Let him be a tzaddik. Usually, people that are tzaddikim, they're good people. And his head is not toward me to fight now. So why Esav, he came to fight his brother. And he came with a big army. And then suddenly, Esav, he gave him a hug, and he started to kiss him, he started to cry. What's going on here? What was his... what happened exactly? He came to fight, and suddenly, he changed his mind for shalom, for peace. My friend, I have to tell you this. People who don't know what it is, this Torah, they hate Torah. A lot of times when I tell people that I have a yeshivot, I have institutions where people study Torah, they ask me, why they waste their time to study Torah? Why? Why does they have to waste their time? Why? I tell them, it's not wasting of time. It's a law. It's a mitzvah. Not everyone has this opportunity, the chance to stay to study Torah all day long, day and night. No, you must deserve it. Not everyone deserves to study Torah, and so the people tell me, okay, why not 1 hour a day? He said yes. Usually people who work, they study 1 hour a day, half an hour a day. I told them, look, it's impossible that everybody will study Torah, because we need money. Because if everybody study Torah, from where we're gonna live? So we need people, Issachar and Zvulun. We need people to study Torah, and we need people to work so they can support those who study Torah. Because otherwise, it's like the children and the parents. The father work for the children, for his children, to feed them. To feed his wife, to feed his family. Imagine if everybody, this is the way. This is Issachar and Zvulun. So, this is what Hashem, when Hashem, he created the world, Hashem created the world that without Torah, the world cannot exist. Why Torah? Because when you study Torah, that connects you to Hashem. Just to know that there is some people who study Torah that protect the world. The world who created for this. Okay, not everyone can study Torah. Not everyone can study Torah. But I have to tell you one thing. Don't think, anyone here who is listening to me, don't think that all of us, we must stay all day long, day and night, study Torah. No. There is only some that Hashem, like the Rambam said, there is the soldiers, an army. Army who protect the city. Without an army, you cannot protect the country. You need an army with weapons. Not everybody is an army? No. There is civilian and there is the army. The civilian are eating, are working, and the army, they protect. So those who study Torah are the army to protect the world. The zechut, the merit of the Torah, protect the world. Why? This is the way it was created, the world. Hashem, because the Torah Kiddusha, because the Torah, this is, because it's not only... Because even those people, the citizen, knowing that there is the army, they can go and sleep tranquil. The same, when we know that there is people who study the Torah, we can go and sleep tranquil. Because those people who study the Torah, through their Torah, they protect the world. So, my friend, a man who don't swear, don't curse, a man who is he has his generosity, a man who gives tzedakah, a man who don't talk lashon hara, bad language, a man who pray, a man who do business without stealing money from to others, not to steal to a Jew, not to steal to a non-Jew. This is Torah. Torah doesn't mean stay all day to study Torah. Torah eats when you don't harm other people. The Haftarah, you love your neighbor like yourself. You do good things to everybody, to the animals, to the Jews, to the non-Jews, to be a nice man. This is Torah. When you are not Baal Gava, you know, there is a lot of people that are arrogant. This is a quality that God hates, arrogance. When you are not arrogant, you are humble. This is Torah. Torah, it's not just stay all day in front of a book. No. Let the army to study Torah for you. You just, the way you act good, this is as well Torah. My friend, so there is people, unfortunately, that they think that we don't need the army of Torah, that it's a waste of time. But they don't know that because of them, the world is protected. So they hid them. I remember one day, somebody come to the yeshiva, and he saw other students. You know what he told me? I don't want to support you anymore. I said, why? See, because they waste time. Why they don't go to work? I told him, if they work, there'd be nobody to study Torah. I told him, here you see, only 1% of the Jews who study Torah. And this is the army. He did not understand. Unfortunately, one day he lost money. He lost a lot of money. So, when he came to see me, he said, Rabbi, I'm sorry, I cannot give you like I used to give you before because I lost. I said, you know why you lost? Maybe because of what you said. So you know what he told me? He said, I don't think so. What a connection. Then he lost everything. He did bad business. Then he came one day to tell me, maybe it's because I spoke bad about them. Now please, Rabbi, give me a bracha. I said, B'ezrat Hashem, I give you the bracha. I hope that Hashem will help you again. But we have to be conscious that without Torah, we are nothing. It doesn't mean that all of us has to study Torah. It's impossible. At least we have to make sure that there is some that they can study Torah and we have to support them. Why take risk? Why take risk by not supporting them? And we understand why they don't go to work, why they don't go to university. Look, these people who go to university to become doctor, engineer, informatic, lawyers, you know. And there is yeshiva, which is an university, Leavdil. There, they study Torah. There, in the Torah, there is everything. Look, I am a rabbi. If I was not in the yeshiva, so I would not be a rabbi. You know, out of thousands who study Torah, there will be some rabbis that will be leaders to the Jews. So we need those. Look, you have 1,000 people in a university that they want to be a doctor, but only 10 or 20 become a doctor. The rest, they're not doctor. And the Torah, when they study Torah, all of them they will be doctors, all of them they will be rabbis. But between them and Akashu, they are rabbis, and they are as well the army of Hashem, as the Rambam said. My friend, now you understand. Esav HaRasha, he has all his life had an opportunity to study Torah. He was with Abraham. Abraham Avinu was his grandfather. Yitzhak was his father. Yaakov is his brother. Why did not match them? Why did not learn from them? But Esav, he chose other life. He could not understand why a man should stay and study Torah. He hates those who study Torah. And for Yaakov, Abinu Alav Shalom, Yaakov, he wanted to teach his children. Look, my children, I have a brother. His name is Esav. He never studied Torah. He hates those who study Torah. Look, when I will tell him that I studied Torah all the time that I was with Lavan, he will get angry and he will come to fight me. He wants to teach his children, when you become a nation, if you don't support the Torah and you don't study the Torah, you become Oyev Torah. You will hate those who study Torah. That's what Yaakov, he wants to teach his children. First, Yaakov, he wants to teach his children that they were with him, that you should never be ashamed of your Judaism. Second, he wants to teach his children, those who live with people that they are Rishaim, they can remain tzaddikim if they want. Like his own, let's say, exactly, he take himself as an example. He said to each other, look, we were with Lavan, and Baruch Hashem, we did not learn from him. So it's up to us. And teach his children, I'm going to send an army, I'm going to send to my brother to tell him that I am rich and that I am a rabbi. You will see what he's going to do. He's going to come to fight me because he hates those who study Torah. Because a man who don't know what it is Torah, he will hate the Torah. As I told you now, that's what he wanted to teach his children. But he wanted to teach his children another thing. When Esav, he will come to fight me, because he will not understand why I am in the Torah, because he will think, this man, the Torah can protect him. This man, he want to teach me that even with Lavan, he remains a tzaddik, and this man, with Lavan, the Rasha, he become rich. This man, he's not afraid of me. He sent me messengers to tell me that he's coming, I'm going to fight him. But Yaakov, he said to his children, look, my children, the zechut of the Torah, the merit of the Torah is very strong. Let's pray to Hashem to be protected. So Yaakov, he started to pray to Hashem, Hashem, you promised me to protect me, so show to my children that you can protect those who study Torah, those who study Torah to go and they do good things. So Esav, the tefillah of Yaakov was accepted by Hashem, and Esav right away he changed the way that he wanted. He wanted to kill Yaakov, now he changed his mind. I would like just to tell you this. In my life, a lot of times, I went through a lot of bad things in my life, and through tefillah to Hashem, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, help. I was in Argentina last week. And there was a big game in Argentina, Rivers against two big teams. It was last Thursday. And the streets were empty. So I said to Mr. Swed, I said, usually here in this area, there is a lot of traffic. Why it's empty? He said, well, Rabbi, everybody is a home watching this big game. Ah, I understand. So I told him, you support what? So he said, well, I support... So he told me the team that he supports. So he told me, Rabbi, please, can you give a bracha that they will win? I said, give a bracha. If they win, what I'm going to win? And if they win, what you will win? He said, it's a pleasure. So I told him, okay, I will pray that they will win. And really, I prayed. I said, I pray to Hashem that they will win. 1-0. At least one. And then we went to his house. We were eating. And suddenly, we heard a big goal. You know, it's like something that was near you. So, on the table, everybody stand up and they said, they were happy. So I said, what's going on? He said, no, I think they mark a goal. I said, you are so happy because they mark a goal. He said, yes, you pray to Hashem and your tefillah went. I said, I said to them, why didn't pray for Mashiach to come? Why didn't pray for something else? So I pray for them to win, so they won. I don't think so. They won, but I won what? And then I went to shul, to the synagogue, and there was somebody who came to see me in the synagogue on Shabbat, and he told me, Rabbi David, thank you for the bracha that you did for our team that they won. It was fabulous. He said, you cannot imagine, I was there with my son. We were excited. Then the goal came, we were happy. And then the game finished. And then I took my son, and we were crying for joy. He was crying, I was crying. And I said, you were crying. Why? He said, because they won. For that you cry, because they won. They won. What did you win? And that hurt me very much. Because I was thinking, have we done in our life a mitzvah with a big happiness, with excitement, with tears? For a football game, people are excited, they prepare themselves, they don't sleep, they don't eat, they're excited, watching the TV, watching when the goal, when it will be a goal. Have we been one day waiting to do a mitzvah with excitement, to do it with happiness, like, goal! Like this jump, crying. For a game that we win nothing, we do all this, we give all this kind of cover to the game, and for Hashem, never. We did a mitzvah with love, like we love the football. You know, after 120 years, Hashem, He will ask every one of us, have you done a mitzvah with excitement? The same way you were excited to see the football. What will be the answer? Have you screamed with happiness, with joy, when a mitzvah comes to your hand? The same, you jump, screaming, crying, when you hear, you see the team breaking a goal? Never. So you love the game, you love the football more than me. Of course, my friend, when we don't know what it is Torah, We know only what it is, football. The same way we can love football, why do we love God the same way we love football? Do we love God the same way we love money? Do we love God the same way we love our wives, children, food? This is something that we have to think. But because you don't know, so God is, football came to a priority, everything is a priority before God. So that's what Yaakov Abinu, he wanted to teach Esav to his children. Yaakov, he wanted to teach his children to Esav that by me, Im Laban Garti, my priority is Tariyak Mitzvah, my priority is the Torah first. After the money, by Yilishur Baka, then first Yaakov, he don't talk about money, he talk about God. Im Laban Garti, I was poor, and I was living with Laban, that he was a Rasha. I could learn from him, but I did not, I made sure not to learn from him. Because the Laban, he gave priority to all the material. I did not learn from him. For me, it was Hashem, my priority. Laban Garti. Garti is Tariag Mitzvot, 613 Mitzvot. That were my priority. After it was the money. That's what Yaakov wanted to teach his children and wanted to give to tell Esav. But because of Esav, his priority before God, before everything, it's money, so he was not agree with him. He came to fight him. But when Yaakov prayed to Hashem to protect him, because from Esav, his brother, so his tefillah was accepted, and Esav changed his mind. Not because he changed his mind, because he wanted to change his mind. No, because Hashem made him change his mind. Because Hashem made him change his mind. And when he changed his mind, so he gave him a big hug and he started to cry and kiss him. That was a big teaching that Yaakov wanted to teach us. That your enemy, he can become your friend and he can change his mind from bad to good. When you show him and you prove him that Hashem is your priority. So, God bless you, and I'll see you next week. And I wish you all the best, and Vayishlach.